I'm Scott Walker, and this is Walks on the Wild Side. In today's video, we're going to talk about gimbal heads on monopods. Can you? Should you? And if so, when? Welcome back to Walks on the Wild Side, the channel where I help you capture the beauty of nature through your camera lens. I make videos about all aspects of nature photography, wildlife, macro, woodland, landscapes and more, and I previously made a video on how to properly set up and balance your gimbal head on a tripod, and I received a number of questions from people about whether it's possible to use a gimbal head on a monopod. And it absolutely is. It's something that I do regularly. So I'm going to give you five scenarios where I think you'll find it useful to use your gimbal head on a monopod. Now, perhaps you've used this setup for yourself in the past and you've got some tips to share with others. If so, please make a note of them in the comments section below because I'm sure people will find that useful. Let's talk about how. So I've got my Sony A9 mounted with my Sony 200-600 on a Kenro gimbal and Kenro monopod. And in the previous video, we talked about a number of the different knobs that you use to control the gimbal head. And if you've not watched that video, please go ahead and do so. I'll link to it above and in the description below. And we're going to talk about those knobs again today. So the first one of those is the panning knob, and you want to make sure that that's fully tightened because you've got absolutely no need to be panning using the gimbal head. You can simply twist the monopod. Next, we've got the tilting knob, and you want to make sure that that's loosened off. So you can raise and lower the position of your camera, and it will maintain its own stability and position as long as you keep the monopod in a fairly upright position. And even though the monopod is a lot less stable than a tripod, it stays exactly where you leave it. And finally, we're going to talk about the knob that allows you to move your position of your camera from landscape to portrait, and that you'll find just here on the collar of your lens. So scenario one is when you've got to cover long distances. For example, if you're scouting a species or you're out trekking with your camera. Now today I'm trekking along this lovely stretch of river looking for some species that I'm hoping to photograph in the near future. And so I've got a long distance to cover, and it's so much easier to travel with my gimbal on a monopod because it's lighter. And you can do this in a number of ways. So you can travel with it around your neck and you can walk a fairly long distance like that. I tend to like to have mine over my shoulder this way, and I can very quickly put it in position and start photographing when I need to. Your other alternative is that you can use your camera strap and put it round your neck and leave the monopod mounted. Now, you want to make sure if you do so that your strap is attached to the lugs of your lens. You don't want to be doing that if the strap is attached to the camera, because that puts the weight of the whole setup on your camera's mount and it's liable to break. So that mount would be carrying the weight of the camera, the lens, the gimbal and the monopod, and it's going to be very costly to fix a problem like that. So I do sometimes use the camera strap, but you must always make sure that the strap is attached to the lugs of your lens. Scenario two is when you need to change height quickly. Now, whatever monopod you're using, that's going to mean making a few adjustments to the legs. Now, my monopod has got twist locks on it. Yours may have clip locks. It doesn't matter. Whatever it is, you're going to have to adjust them to raise or lower the height of the monopod. And if you're using a tripod, you've got three sets of legs to adjust. So that takes three times as long. There's a local population of goldcrests that I regularly photograph, and they live in yew trees, and they're frequently up and down, and I never know whether they're going to be up high or down low. They often don't come out of the tree, they'll be quite a way inside it. And so I'm always moving positions so that I can get them in the frame. And I find using my monopod allows me to much more quickly change my position than it would be if I was using my tripod. Scenario three is when I'm shooting video. Now I find it really easy to be able to use the monopod to track a bird flying through the sky or a deer running across the landscape. And you might say to yourself, well, couldn't you do that with a fluid head? And absolutely, that's what fluid heads are designed for. But do you really want to be carrying around a fluid head with a gimbal as well for when you're shooting stills? Now, if you don't know what a fluid head is, it's a head that you might mount your camera to, but it's got a little bit of hydraulic fluid in it that resists the motion, and it forces you to go a little bit slower, and it makes sure that any movements that you've got are smooth. So a fluid head can be difficult if you're tracking something that's moving really fast or something that's moving in a really erratic way. So a gimbal gives you a lot more flexibility to move fast, but you sacrifice a little bit of the smoothness that you would get from a fluid head. The other advantage to using the gimbal on a monopod is that you can punch in and pull out. So what I mean by that, if you need to get a little bit closer, you can just lean over. As long as you don't lean too far, the monopod doesn't fall over, or you can pull backwards. And so effectively, you've got a little bit of extra zoom give and take that you get through having a monopod rather than a tripod. Scenario four is when I'm using my pop-up hide. Now, if you've not seen this before, I'll link to a video above and below where I use the hide, but effectively it allows me to carry the hide a distance, put it up and be hidden away from whatever it is that I'm trying to photograph. And that hide is quite a small enclosed space. So having my camera on a gimbal on a tripod takes up a lot of space in the footwell, where I may have the bag that I brought all my camera gear in, the bag that I brought the hide in, as well as my second camera for shooting video. So using the monopod gives me a lot more foot room within the hide. And that's really important because you have to be comfortable. If you can't be comfortable, you're not going to be able to stay there long. And sometimes I sit in that hide for hours waiting for the subject that I want to come along and capture the shot that I'm looking for. So comfort is king. And scenario five is when I'm having a day of birding. So usually when I go to photograph something, I'm shooting species specific. I will have researched the species that I want to photograph, found where they'll be, found the positions, and I'll very often know which bank of a pond, which stretch of a river, which part of a field, and even which branch of a tree I'm going to aim at to get the species that I want. But sometimes it's great just to have a bit of fun, turn up at a nature reserve and photograph whatever comes along. And having my camera on a monopod allows me to very quickly get into position and take a photo quick as a flash so that I can capture whatever I see that day. So those are the five scenarios where I regularly use my gimbal head on a monopod. And perhaps with those ideas, you can go out and try this for yourself. Now, if you don't have a monopod, you might not even need to buy one. Many tripods nowadays come with a detachable leg that allows you to remove one of them and use it as a monopod. So check your tripod. Can you take off one of the legs and mount your gimbal on it to use it as a monopod? If you found this video useful, please click the like button and don't forget to subscribe so that you get notified next time I put out some content. If you've got any questions, queries or comments, please make a note of them below and I'll be happy to answer them. Thanks very much for watching and I'll see you next time.